drink my blood abide in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe, and who was the one that would betray him, and he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Take my lips, O Lord, and speak through them. Take our minds, O Lord, and think through them. Take our hearts, O Lord, and set them on fire with love for you. Amen. Reading because I have studied for a long time. then as a youth leader, as a Christian formation person, as a Sunday school teacher, again, church administrator, all of it, and finally priest and chaplain, I've come to find Jesus' message somewhat difficult and tricky. Because Jesus does not teach in an orderly way. He confuses, he obfuscates, and teaches as much with his actions as he does with his words, perhaps even more so. He has what we in the education biz call a strong secondary curriculum. It's not just about what he says, it's about how he lives. And to those of us who seek to follow and comprehend Jesus 2,000 years at a distance, it's exceedingly hard to get Jesus, to understand him in a way that we are comfortable with, to wrap our heads around his message. But this may, in fact, be our biggest problem. Jesus perhaps is not inviting us to understand, but rather to be formed, to be shaped, not merely to learn. You see, formation is about the process of becoming. It's not about the mastery of content, it's about shaping our lives in the light of Jesus' revelation of God's character. It has no interest in mastery, but a great interest in the formation of character and purpose and vocation. Now, I know that you also have probably been reading the New York Times and other blogs online, and you've seen, no doubt, that character has become a big word these days, especially in light of David Brooks' new book, The Road to Character. I'm certain that you probably preached from it, Randy, but I've been so absent that I haven't heard it. But Brooks is a New York Times columnist, and his New York Times columns, if you read them closely, they suggest that Brooks himself has been on a journey lately. And his latest book, The Road to Character, sort of sketches out for us more about where he hopes, perhaps, this journey might take him. In this most recent book, he uses an extended metaphor borrowed from the 20th century rabbi named Joseph Soloveitchik, don't quite know how to pronounce it, who notes that there are two accounts of creation in Genesis, and argue that these represent the two opposing sides of our nature, which the rabbi calls Adam 1 and Adam 2. Brooks writes, Adam 1 is the career-oriented, ambitious side of our nature. Adam 1 is the external resume Adam. Adam 1 wants to build, create, produce, and discover things. He wants to have high status and win victories. Adam 2 is the internal Adam. Adam 2 wants to embody certain moral qualities. Adam 2 wants to have a serene inner character, a quiet but solid sense of right and wrong, not only to do good, but to be good. Adam 2 wants to love intimately, to sacrifice self in the service of others, to live in obedience to some transcendent truth, to have a cohesive inner soul that honors creation and one's own possibilities. While Adam 1 wants to conquer the world, Adam 2 wants to obey a calling to serve the world. Continues later, I've also become more aware that, like many people these days, I, that is to say Brooks, have lived a life of vague moral aspiration, vaguely wanting to be good, vaguely wanting to serve some larger purpose while lacking a concrete moral vocabulary, a clear understanding of how to live a rich inner life, or even a clear knowledge of how character is developed and depth is achieved. Discovered that without a rigorous focus on the Adam 2 side of our nature, it's easy to slip into a self-satisfied moral mediocrity. I'd like to introduce Brooks to worship here. You could certainly find a guide. The Adam 2 path is the road to character, a life based on a strong moral compass where life is navigated by instinct and service to others, rather than calculated to achieve the most beneficial end. You and I do not have a vague model of how to live out this character. We are given the model and the way, the truth, and the life, the way of Jesus, the Christian way. It is this way that Jesus teaches and models and offers to us. This is a difficult teaching. Who can accept it? This summer I've been away, and not just because I've been lazy, but I've been away and I've traveled far and wide. The farthest I went this summer was to South India, and I went with a group of 6 students to South India to a place called Bangalore. And while in Bangalore, we studied how the Indian culture transmits values and education. And so we went to lots of different educational institutions, from low-cost private schools to very high-cost international private schools, and then to some tuition-free schools with a social mission. And the best of these, the most remarkable of these, was a school called the Ananya Trust. And I trust that you've never heard of the Ananya Trust, nor will you hear much more about it if you search the web. But the Ananya Trust is a school founded by a woman named Shashi Rao. And Shashi is a University of Pennsylvania PhD graduate and an Indian woman who began this trust to educate and form the poorest Indian children that she could find. And when she began the school, she went out into the streets and she found children picking rags, and children helping their parents, and children with no education, and she invited them to come to a little oasis that she had set up in her home to learn. And the goal of this education was twofold. Not simply was it about skills, but also to teach them they had value, that they were loved. And when I asked her, I said, well, what are your hoped-for outcomes, Dr. Rao? What's your measure of success? She said, you need to free up your mind. I have no hoped-for outcome. I want these children to know that they are loved, that they have value. If, when they leave this place, they came to us as rag pickers, they go home as rag pickers, but they're slightly more, I don't know, aware that God and others love them, I'm fine with that. I was stunned, because that's not our goal at Episcopal, certainly. We would like people to know that they are loved, but we'd also like them to get into Harvard, possibly, but that's not the same mission. And she told me that once students knew that they were loved and cherished, the rest would follow. She said that knowing that you are loved comes before knowing anything else. Knowing that you are loved frees her students to know first the way that they have lived is not the way that they must live for the rest of their lives. Jesus, in his teaching and in his preaching and his embodiment of and enactment of the kingdom of God through his miracles and ultimately his death and God's act of raising Jesus from the dead, teaches us the same thing. That the way we have lived is not the way we must live for the rest of our lives. We can and could live differently. This is the heart of Christian formation. It is the whole substance of the church's teaching, and it is offered under the symbol of God's generous gift of his life and the bread and wine of our altar. Hugh St. Victor, a sort of not very well-known writer, wrote in the turn of the second millennium, 1090 about, a book called The Soliloquy on Love. It says the first millennium. The Soliloquy on Love, and it was inspired by his companionship with St. Augustine. And he wrote about God. He said, God drew us to his image. He willed to draw to himself through a likeness those whom he drew to himself by love. There he gave us to be, and to be beautiful. You are charged with a great debt, O my soul. For what is given through love cannot be better, nor more suitably repaid, than by love. You have received all this through love. For God was able to have given life to his other creatures, but in this life he loved you more. Nor did he love you more because he found more to love in you, but because he loved you more gratuitously. He made you such that now he loves you more by merit. It is that love which enfolds us. It's that love which embraces us and draws us to God's self and forms us. It is in that love that you and I are invited not only to learn As Solomon declares in 1 Kings, heaven and earth cannot contain God. And yet, you and I have been invited not only to know this God, but to live within the abundance of God's love. This is what theologians call our interdependent life in God, our mutual indwelling of God's grace. Not only do we know about God, but we come to know God through God's invitation to dwell in God through love. This is a difficult teaching. Who can accept it? You and I can know God even more fully and be formed for God's work by participating in God's love and engaging in God's work, to encounter God in prayer and worship and listen for God's invitation to serve others, to rest in God and enter more deeply into God's redeeming mystery. That is the vocation of every Christian, not just those of us who teach. In this way, we are formed through love into people of character, people of love, people of the kingdom, citizens with the saints, and beloved of God. This is Christian character. It is not simply learned, but practiced and experienced. It's the context, the atmosphere in which we are called to live our lives and not the subject of our study. In the face of this revelation of God's love, you and I can shed our fears about religion, about the rules, about our history of abuse, neglect, and misuse of God's generous love in the past, and learn to abide in the generosity of God's love in the present. The generosity of love that heals, restores, forgives, and inspires. And it is this love that promises always to love us to the end. And in the end, it raises us up as it raised up Jesus. This is a difficult teaching. Who can accept it? My beloved wife, when I was writing this sermon, suggested to me that I didn't need to say a word at all. She said that someone else had written all that I needed to say, and she said that this is it. I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall not hunger. Those who believe in me, they shall never thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father draws them, and I will raise them up. We have come to believe.